As you have already heard from the previous speaker, Nicoletta, in Europe in general, we have grape wine yellows. The two main diseases are Gois Noir and Flavus sauce dorée. And the damages of this caused by these diseases are very, very serious. So there is an important decrease of the quantity and of the quality of the production, and also the death of the plant, especially for the variety that are most susceptible. You can see here in the photos what a disaster can happen in a field and how the bunches can become after the disease. In general, the control strategies now rely on insecticide treatments against vector. It's not the only one, not the only strategy, but is the most important. Then there is also obviously the control of the removing of the diseased plant. There are the monitoring, the survey of the insect and also of the plants, but the insecticide treatments are the base. So obviously there is a need for new, more sustainable and eco-friendly control methods, as all Europe and all the world wish. So we start from this observation. The varieties, different Vitis vinifera varieties, has got and show different susceptibility to the disease and to the phytoplasm as the pathogen. And it was observed for years in the field, especially when we have a collection of different varieties in the same vineyard, where the pressure of the disease can be estimated as homogeneous. Here you see an example. This is a vineyard, and every row is a different variety or a different clone of a variety. In red, you see the infected plants. This is like a photo of 1 year. And in white, the healthy plants. That was the situation after, 5-6 years of the epidemics, that the epidemics went on. So it's not yesterday, no plant, this not infected plant, and today is like that. This is the results of several years of infection. As you can see, it's very interesting to see that there are some varieties where the number of the diseased plant is higher than others. In particular, you see in the middle of this vineyard, there are some rows that are completely or almost completely healthy. So what we decided to do? We decided to choose two varieties. One is Tokaj Friulano, which is an autochthonous variety of north or east of Italy. As you can see, it doesn't have usually infected plants, even if the plants close by are diseased and the vector is present. So it shows a sort of resistance. And we wanted to compare this one with another one, Chardonnay, for example. Chardonnay is known in all the world to be a very susceptible variety. I mean, Chardonnay, when is infected by phytoplasmas, if, I mean, the life can be 3-4 years and then the plant is condemned to die. On the opposite, if it happens that Tokaj Friulano becomes infected and is quite rare, usually the year afterwards, the plant is able to recover from the disease, and you see it, the plants that the 1 year was symptomatic, the year afterwards looks healthy. And actually also with the molecular methods, the diagnostic methods, we are not able to find the phytoplasma inside. So what we can say from this observation, that we imagine the existence of genetic traits responsible for the resistance, and we don't know if the resistance is against the vector or against the pathogen. It has to be discovered. And based on that, we carried out a preliminary work based on next generation sequencing technique. I will not explain you what it is because it's quite complicated, but you know, there are this new technique, very innovative, based on sequencing of DNA, so or RNA. So a work that compared the a variety like Tokaj Fiulano with Chardonnay show that the FD phytoplasm, in this case, so the grape wine yellow phytoplasm, was able to repress the plant responses induced by the vector feeding in susceptible varieties in Chardonnay. While in the Tokaj Fiulano, which is not completely but partially resistant, we observed that this variety was able to face the pathogen at the vector, how using passive defense mechanism, but also a prompt reaction or further active defenses. In imagine, you can imagine Chardonnay like somebody without a capacity of defense itself, and Tokaj Fiulano like somebody ready to go to the war, okay? So the aim of the work in this project was exactly to identify the genetic traits or the genes responsible for the resistance to grape wine yellows in grapevine. Why? Because in order to be able in the future to use these traits to obtain resistance also in other varieties which are susceptible. And how? By means of crossing, traditional crossing or breeding, or also cisgenesis, we will see, but also using biostimulants, as it is happening actually for other grapevine pathogens. Sure, you know, grapevine resistant to downy and powdery mildew. And how did we work on this topic? By two main approaches. So the first one is the identification of what is called quantitative trait loci, which means simply this piece of the chromosome of the grapevine that contain the traits for the resistance. And we want to identify them how by genotyping, so sequencing, and phenotyping, which means to look for the susceptibility of the disease on a population of grapevine that was obtained crossing the Chardonnay with the Tokaj Fiulano. And the second approach is the whole genome sequencing of two Chardonnay clones that showed a different susceptibility to grape wine yellows, and also studying the transcriptome profile of the early stage of the infection. I will explain you better in the next slide, obviously. Looks complicated. I mean, it is complicated, but it is understandable, and I will explain you. So first, this is the classical approach to discover the QTL, which are these traits where the resistance is included. So in 2017, but also before, we made the crossing of the Tokaj Fiulano resistant with the Chardonnay susceptible. Crossing, you know, it means to is something, let's say, artificial, because usually the grapevine is able to cross with itself. So we took the male and the female, and we make a new progeny of sons of Tokaj Fiulano crossed with the Chardonnay. Why? Because when you have a progeny, so a lot of sons of two different parents, which are opposite in the resistance, you will obtain in the sons, in the progeny, all the different grade of the resistance and susceptibility. You can imagine that we obtained a lot of plants, that we had 5,000 seeds, and we decided to grow only 600 sons, which are called biotypes, actually. So we have 600 biotypes from the seeds, plantlet, And then when the plantlet became bigger, we multiplied them by clonal multiplication, so just cuttings, and obtaining at least 20 plants per each biotype. So we go on to the nursery and then to the vineyard, and this is our vineyard. Then what is needed to do? You see here, in the older vineyard, we already have some symptoms of the disease. You see this yellow in the middle is a grapevine, son of the Tokay and Chardonnay, which is infected by grapevine yellows. What we need to do? We need to discover the genotype of each of these sons and to join these features with the susceptibility to the disease. So what we call phenotyping, how we can do to check it, to discover it. We prepare some cages, as you see in the photo on the right hand side below, cages that inside has the infective vector. And we put one of each for each grapevine. You can imagine how many of them. Actually, we didn't finish yet, but we are at a good step. Okay. So what we want is that this grapevine, we want to put these grapevines, these biotypes, under the pressure of the disease and see how many of them become infected and how many of them are not infected, although we have put inside the infective vector. So the disease is there, but they are able to face it. And with this data, with the genomic data, the genotyping, we obtained a genetic linkage map of the progeny. Why? Because this is important. And you joining the phenotype observation with the genotype data by means of statistical methods that are running on huge computer, as you can imagine, we will find which part in which chromosome and which part of the chromosome the trait that is associated to the resistance is placed. So maybe it's one trait or two or three, we don't know. Obviously, we hope just a few, but we will be able to visualize it in the chromosome of the grapevine and know where it is. So if we know it, like it's already known for some resistant trait to downy mildew and powdery mildew, we will use it to cross and to implement it in other varieties. Okay, this is the first part of the work. We are still finishing, obviously. And the second is about the two clones of Chardonnay I told you before. So, it happened some years ago that we found a vineyard with two different clones of Chardonnay. One clone was completely destroyed by the disease, and the other was healthy. I mean, not 100% healthy, the plants, but the difference was really important. So, as you can imagine, they are both Chardonnay. So there is something different in the Chardonnay, in these two clones of Chardonnay, but they are the same variety. So the differences are easier to be found out that in different varieties. I mean, if we compare Tokay and Chardonnay, there are many, many differences because they are different varieties. But if we compare two clones of the same variety, we are more focalized on the differences. So it's easier to find out the trait that is associated to the resistance or to the susceptibility, both. So what we did, we are doing, and we did a whole genomic sequencing of both clones, and we are just analyzing the data now to see if there are differences between one and the other. And it's very interesting to see that we find out some transposon. If somebody knows what they are. So there are some pieces of DNA that jump from a part of another of the chromosomes, and they are often associated with changing in the phenotype of the grapevine. So for example, if you imagine some variant of the color of the same variety, like the Pinot, Gris, Blanc, and Noir, sometimes this change in the color is often associated to a transposon. Okay? So it's a good indication and we want to go on. And then what we did is the transcriptome analysis during the early stage of the infection. I will show you in a few seconds how we did it. Then the strategy is to join together these two approaches to find out the differences. So, first, as I told you, the genome of the two Chardonnay clones was sequenced with the two approaches. We chose two approaches because in this way our sequencing can be more precise and detailed. So one is the PacBio and the other is Illumina. Both of them are really the technology that are the last found out in the world, in literature. And the other is the transcriptomic profile study. So here is easier to explain. I mean, what we did is we took, okay, the two different clones, and we studied first what we call the constitutive gene expression. So it means which genes are expressed in the susceptible clone of Chardonnay and in the less susceptible clone of Chardonnay when they are healthy. So is the difference that is constitutive, let's say something that is already inside them. And second, in green, we studied the expression of the genes that were induced by the vector but healthy. So what does it mean? It means that we put the insect on the plants and we observe how the two clones are able to react. Okay. Why the healthy vector? Because we cannot directly infect the plants with the phytoplasma, the agent of the grapevine disease, because we cannot handle it. So we can use only the vector to transmit the phytoplasma to the plants. And the third experiment, it was to compare the genes that are, let's say, moved by the two different clones when they are under the infection. So we put an infective vector on the plants. It means the vector with inside the pathogen that it was transmitted to the plants. So comparing the difference between the, let's say, frame A, frame B, frame C, and the two different clones, we should understand which are the genes that are used by the less susceptible clone to face the disease, and which are the genes that are the cause of the susceptibility of the first Chardonnay clone, the more susceptible. Okay, I hope that that was not too complicated. And as a last thing before finishing, I want to tell you that we also developed a test for diagnostic of phytoplasmas in grapevine using serological tests, so ELISA tests, which are easier to apply by also the phytosanitary service, for example, to the samples that we need to test. Because usually the test that is used is the molecular ones, which is very, very good, obviously, but it's also quite more complicated to set up. And thank you very much.